So next point that we are going to discuss is our standards of developing and developed nations converging. First of all, we will give you a brief background of what is meant by convergence and divergence. So first term is divergence. So divergence is a tendency for a per capita income to grow faster in high income countries than in low income countries. So tendency for a per capita income to grow faster in high income countries than low income countries, so that income gap widens across the countries over time. So it means that if there is divergence, it means that rich countries are growing faster. So let me write it here. So growth of rich countries are greater than growth of poor countries, which means that the gap between rich and poor will increase in time. So it means the poor will not be able to become rich countries. So this is divergence hypothesis. It means a few of the economists claim that there is divergence, and divergence means the rich countries are growing faster because of some reasons, and because of their fast growth, they are creating a gap between rich and the poor. So it means poor will not be able to reach the richness level. And on the other side, convergence hypothesis is that the growth of poor will be greater than growth of rich. So it means the gap between rich and poor will increase in time, will decrease in time. So it means the poor will eventually be equal to the rich, and they will grow as fast as rich countries. So it means there are two subgroups in development economics. One is saying that there is a convergence. It means eventually poor countries will become rich. We only need to give them support. And there are other types of people who are following divergence theory. They are saying that the poor country will never become rich because of their logics that they provide, which we'll discuss later on. So it means we need some drastic changes so that the current situation is changed, so that the poor countries can grow fast enough to compete with the rich countries and become rich in the future. So this is the convergence and divergence hypothesis. Okay, so first of all, we'll start with the logics for convergence. Why do we think that there will be convergence? First reason is because of technology transfer. Okay, so the technology transfer is the first reason that it could talk about the technology transfer. So we have defined GR is growth of rich and GP is growth of poor. Okay, so it was noted previously. So first reason is due to transfer of technology and so the richness here does mean the development. So here I use the word rich for development and the poor for underdeveloped. So you can change it to growth of developed and growth of underdeveloped. So the objective of every country is to develop, because we already studied in microeconomics that every person wants to maximize his utility. So there is no one who will accept a low income or low development level. So the target is to increase the standard of living. So if we make the benchmark of rich countries as best possible standard of living, so since poor countries are observing the rich countries enjoying standard of living, so their objective will be to enjoy same life. That's why each country wants to be rich, so that they have same type of standard of living, so that there is no inequality in that thing. So there will be no hatred, there will be more peace. So that is required here. So first logic for the convergence is technology transfer. So developing countries do not have to reinvent the wheel. The idea is that whenever they do a technology, they are inventing something. So, but the poor countries, they don't have to reinvent. They don't have to do R&D. They can leapfrog the early stages of development by early stages of technology development by adopting from rich. It means that we can just adopt their technology and then do improvement in that, rather than we develop our new technology. The example is that UK doubled their output per person in 60 years using their process. USA did it in 45 years because they adopted from UK. South Korea did it in 12 years and China did it in 9 years. So this example tells us that the time it takes to double the income output of the country. So since the new country is taking less time, the reason is that they are adopting from the success stories, from the adopting the technologies and processes from the previous countries. So it is not, they are not taking that much time. This concept is called advantage of backwardness. So advantage of backwardness is that that you can just copy that that research or the process rather than invent yourself. So it means it will take, the poor countries will take less time. So poor country will take less time to grow if they adopt the processes and technology from the rich countries, which took time to develop. For them, the process took time to develop. For us, it's already available, so we don't have to develop it again. So we can enjoy, we can avoid the reinvention of wheel, and we can enjoy the advantage of backwardness. So the convergence hypothesis gave this first reason that we can enjoy convergence because we can adopt. So next is the second reason is due to similar factor, similarity in factor accumulation. So since the developing economies have high physical and human capital and they have already engaged them, so now they are in the law of diminishing return state. So the rich countries have huge amount of capital and labor. So they theoretically should be in the law of diminishing returns, because let's write it here. So they have already invested their capital in ventures where there was high returns. Now they are left with ventures where the returns are low. So they are enjoying low but stable growth rates, and the ventures that could have given them high growth rates are already finished or they have already developed. So they are working on they are in the state where they have diminishing returns. But on the other hand, the poor countries, now they are able to invest in the ventures which have high returns because they have abundant labor. They only need investment, so they can get an investment from loan or FDI or their own savings, so they can enjoy the higher growth. So let's, if I draw the example here, so suppose this is a y-axis, which is the return rate, and this is the amount of investment. So if I draw a graph here, that rich countries were able to initially enjoy high growth because they were investing in dams, schools, and projects which will give them high growth. But now they are investing in projects which are not giving them high returns. So eventually, theoretically, it should go to zero. But the poor countries were investing in projects which are giving them low returns because they are less productive. They grew slowly, but now if they do investment, they can grow higher. If I use it a different color so that it can be differentiated. So the poor countries were growing slowly. Now if they invest in capital, they can grow higher. And they might see the diminishing returns, but you can see it here that the gap is now being removed because now they can enjoy high growth rates. So this is the logic behind the convergence. Okay, now let's move towards divergence. So first reason for divergence is that there is a diversity among poor countries, which we discussed in the first topic. So all poor countries are not performing similarly. Some of them are facing stagnation, hence it is increasing the gap between the low income and medium income countries. So some countries which were poor are growing good, but they are becoming more different from each other. So so there's a divergence because the very poor countries are still there. Second is the reason of trade bargaining. So all the rich countries have similar conditions and they have the trade bargaining power as they are enjoying trade with lower barriers because they are producing things that we need. So we are forced to buy at a higher price. So they are selling necessities, which include oil, technology, and machinery. And we are selling primary goods, which are perishable, which have substitutes and are perishable. So it means the goods that we are importing, we are forced to buy it expensive. And the goods that we are, let me move it here. The goods that we are exporting, we have many substitutes because there are many agricultural countries. And since it is perishable, we cannot wait to find a better seller, a better buyer. So it means we are forced to sell it as fast as possible so that the perishable goods are not wasted. So it means we do not have a bargaining power in selling and we don't have a bargaining power in buying. So we are not enjoying the trade. So the rich countries are enjoying the trade. Then maturity of institutions. So institutions in the developing countries are not mature enough. You can see the news for the case of Pakistan. There is a conflict between institutions. It will take more time, which is required for convergence. So because of these three reasons, it is to be observed that the convergence will not happen automatically. And if you let it happen, there will be divergence. So there is a drastic change required. It will not happen because of market forces. So convergence says that there will be development because of market forces, which we discussed in micro and macroeconomics. But divergence says that there are barriers which will restrict automatic convergence. So you have to break the barriers or find ways to do development. Okay, so let's see what is the conclusion here. Let me clear the screen. Next, go to the next slide. So because of diversity among the developing countries and failure to achieve convergence, there's a need of special attention in these developing countries. And this course of development economics is designed to achieve this specific objective. Hope it is clear for you that what is the difference between convergence and divergence. So you can ask questions by writing in chat or contacting me. Thank you very much.